Peggy 16.
In Calradia, they say that looking back and telling of a fulfilling life gives you peace of mind. So let me try and see if that is not just nonsense. I was born the son of a hunter. We lived a simple life. It was neither good nor bad. But I do not want to complain. Had I been born a daughter, the world would have been far less welcoming. I learned how to hunt with bow and arrows, and also where it was best to sell furs and meat. But I wanted more. And so I apprenticed to a craftsman early on. Later, I would go trading for him. And then I heard of Calradia, where opportunity and danger were said to exist in equal measure. We can fight our way to the top with swords, charm our way up with our silver tongue, or strive for balance in all aspects of life. We come to Calradia as life has made us. Our experiences help us on the way, but the future is all ours. Like everywhere in the world, life is full of difficult decisions. This was already apparent when looking for a new home. Six realms are fighting for power. Six possible new beginnings await us coming from afar. In the southern deserts, the Sultan of the Saranids reigns over an army of heavily armored cavalry and light infantry. They watch over the oases and flourishing cities, where the roads of the spice trade from all over the world come together. Further north stretch the seemingly endless steppes, where the savage Khergit riders hunt and pillage. Those who love their life stay away from the sea of grass, but with strength, perseverance, and a steady bow arm, you can conquer your place there. Even further north live the Vagias in their eternally snowy realm. Sea raiders keep attacking their coast, in spite of the king's army and his boyars defending their home bravely with spears, bows, and axes. The more civilized relatives of the raider bands live further to the west by the big cove in the north. They call themselves the Nord after their northern home. They have always been proud of their artful way of fighting with axe and shield on foot, but they deeply despise the southern fools on horses. In the center of Calradia lies the realm of Shwadia, home to the best knights in the world. Anybody who has ever seen them charge all clad in steel knows why King Harlaus can even feel safe in a country that is constantly at war with its neighbors. All the way in the southwest, on the rolling hills and along the shoreline, live the Rodok tribes. Time and again, they have to fight Shwadia and the Saranids. They defend their thriving trade routes with large crossbows and long pikes. Luckily, I have always enjoyed traveling. Otherwise, I would have never seen all that Calradia has to offer. With its vast land stretching from the deserts in the south to the coasts in the north. In small villages, serfs slave away for their lords who are often plundered or attacked by bandits. They are wary of strangers. But those who make their life a little easier can earn their trust. The country's nobility rules the surrounding lands and villages from the safety of their 45 castles. Everyone dreams of owning a castle themselves and enjoying the sweet life. But unless you are noble born, you have to go to great lengths to get that far. Back then, I first made for Chariz, one of the big cities of Calradia. Corruption and crime are as widespread here as trade and freedom. The guildmasters send their caravans out to the whole world. In the taverns, the ale is flowing, and those who are looking for goods and equipment can wander the markets for days. I tried to be honest. I really did. I wanted to buy things cheaply in villages and resell them expensively in the cities. Slowly build up something. But soon a hard blow hit me A gang of bandits showed me that one man alone cannot make it far in Calradia. I got some of the bastards. But when they dragged me off my horse, that was the end of it. I needed protection to get my goods safely to their destination. The toughest dogs that coin could buy would serve best. Much coin, as I soon came to realize. I wanted to stay honest, but the cost for my guards was much higher than what my humble trading yielded. Once there is no pay, the lads are gone faster than you can say Calradia. So I had to reduce the cost of my purchases. When the peasants are frightened enough, they will hand over their things for free. After all, I had the swords to intimidate them. And if that was not enough, then their little villages would go up in flames. Good pickings, though, are not found in the cellars of those poor bastards, but in the chests and bags that pass from market to market on the caravans every day. Robbing these fellows is not as easy as giving some peasants a good beating. But even if one of my lads got his head bashed in every once in a while, it was always worth it. Especially if you can trade the peasants' things for weapons and armor that would even make a nobleman green with envy. My chance to lead an honest life depended on high walls and towers that had to be conquered first. When my men told me of a castle that was only held by a few men due to the war, we took a chance. We built a siege tower, took up our bows and crossbows, and made ourselves the lord. The lord that owned the castle was too afraid to lose his army and retreated after a few insults had been exchanged. Luckily, his king did not help him then. Otherwise, my newly won life would have quickly ended in the prison of the fortress I had just conquered. But as is well known, noblemen are prone to forget quickly when they receive gifts. And just like that, I, the bandit, became one of them. Despite the whispers about my origins, they all had to welcome me at their banquet tables. I even participated in their tournaments and increased my wealth with lances and wagers. I captured the hearts of all the noble ladies. They can hardly resist the winner of a tournament, especially if he has already made a name for himself among their brothers and fathers. I was torn between romance and politics, but as the Calradian saying goes, love withers, but land never slithers. But alas, the people remember who had plagued them before longer than their lords. So I had to first regain the trust of my new subjects on the lands around my castle. I did so by chasing precisely the sort of men who, like me before, stole from the weakest to enrich themselves. The crops from my peasants' fields were even enough to host a big banquet for my noble neighbors. Victories in battles bring you honor. But with a feast, you can turn that glory into political alliances and even friendships. I also negotiated my wife's dowry at a lavish banquet. Feasts, weddings, and tournaments were the sunny side of my new life. But the darker side of the coin was that I needed to defend with tooth and nail what I had built up for myself. A siege is a cruel affair. The wait until your enemy arrives at your walls with ladders and towers makes even seasoned men nervous. And the carnage that ensues when they storm the castle always fills the purses of the gravediggers. But I never let them take from me what I had taken myself. So, here I stand and tell you my story. I cannot say it gave me peace of mind, but I am content nevertheless. I took my fate in my own hands. Nobody ever gave anything to me. And that is precisely what gives me peace. I took control of my own destiny.